say hello and welcome me to come here. Okay. All right. Well, welcome. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming. I'm sorry, I went a little grubby. I was up north at the cottage, and I came back to open up the building for Glenn and that. So, but I appreciate you all coming and hearing Glenn out, and I know he's here to listen to you folks, too. I will just tell you this. I worked with Glenn in Madison for many, many years in the State Assembly, 12 years at least, and he is a man of honor, and he respects people, and I think he brings a lot of good things to the table. So may disagree with him, may agree with him tonight, but at least show our United States Congressman some respect. We appreciate you all coming. We have a full house. You're all invited back Wednesday night when we have a council meeting. So we've never ever had this many people for a council meeting. And we always have the chief here too. So we'd like to see you, you know, on a Wednesday night too, first and third Wednesday. So welcome to the council chambers, and I hope this goes really well. So Glenn, welcome to Neenah.
Okay. Say about teens, see a nice thing about me. You know, I served with them in the legislature for 20 years.
20 years, yeah,
20 years. But I don't think there was anybody in Madison who did not like Dean Crawford. And I mean that. You know, since people don't get along, you say that everybody likes Dean. Okay, now what I'll do to explain how we're going to handle this, Al Ott runs my Wisconsin office here out of Fond du Lac, and he's going to explain how we'll answer questions. I'm going to start with 10 or 15 minutes, kind of giving you my opinion as far as what's going on in Washington, maybe tell you some things you don't see in the paper, and then we're going to open it up for questions. But Al, you want to explain how we're going to operate?
Absolutely. So thank you all for coming. The way that we are doing this is when you first came in, had you signed in, and if you wanted to ask a question, you could fill out one of those cards with your question. We will be drawing them at random from this bucket, and we will hand the question back to you as well as the microphone and have you ask your question. If during the course of the meeting you come up with something you wish you would have asked, you can always fill out another card and we'll pop that in the bucket. Anyone whose question is not answered tonight, we will be getting back to you with an answer from our office. So, and Bernadette from our staff in DC is going to be pulling out in the questions. So. That's the format that we're going to use.
Okay, real good. I'll talk a little bit about, maybe try to tell you some things that you haven't read in the paper, or maybe kind of an insider's view of what's going on in Washington. Obviously, it's a very interesting time. New administration, interesting election. Hope springs eternal that we're going to be able to attack some of the major problems that are out there. I'll address a little bit of what's going on in the committees that I'm on, as well as kind of an overview of the major things that I think have to be tackled in Washington. I think the one thing that's been in the paper more than anything else is the Affordable Care Act, or Obamacare. I think a lot of people expected that to be repealed and being taken care of already. I'll explain a little bit what's going on there. Obamacare, something is going to have to be done, because right now, Obamacare, which relies on insurance companies providing insurance under these exchanges, is kind of falling apart. Right now, we're in a situation in which they're only about a third, I'm going to say, in a third of the counties around the country, there's only one insurer on the exchange. Okay, and over time, if you wait till this time of next year, there are going to be a lot of counties in which there are no private insurance companies operating under the exchange, in which case, really, Obamacare will have collapsed. We decided to try to repeal it and replace it in the House of Representatives. We thought we had a bill out there about a month ago, the final week in March. The Republicans, who have the majority in the House right now, we have, I think, 238 congressmen right now. We should have been able to get the 217 votes necessary to come up with something. We met on a Thursday night, and we thought we had a deal. There were probably, in a private meeting, there were probably about 50 Republicans who stood up and spoke and were in favor of the deal. Only one person said no. Some of those people who spoke in favor of it were from a group called the Freedom Caucus, which has a hard time voting yes on things. We were pretty confident, but in the next 18 hours, two groups decided that maybe if they started from scratch and negotiated a little bit harder, they'd get more of what they liked, so things fell apart. To give you an idea, the concerns of the two groups, the conservative groups who are getting a lot of the blame for things not passing, there were a couple things they didn't like. Under the bill that's out there, and I'm sure any bill that will pass, we will cover pre-existing conditions. This makes it difficult for insurance companies because obviously, you know, it'd be like, if you have a car accident, you call the car insurance company and say, I'd like insurance. So it's one of the reasons why Obamacare isn't doing that well. Nevertheless, it is popular enough with the public and enough Republican congressmen when we ran last time, so they're not going to vote for a bill that doesn't include pre-existing conditions. That will be in there. What we have decided to do to help out the insurance companies and prevent people from only getting insurance if they get sick is we said that if you get insurance and then stop getting insurance and try to get insurance again, the insurance company can charge you a premium of about 30%, which hopefully will solve the problem of insurance companies not being able to offer insurance. The next concern some people have is under the plan that's out there, we will give people a tax credit, which isn't like a normal tax credit. It'll be something that you will be able to apply to purchase and through insurance through an insurance company. It varies with your age. It will be $2,000 if you're in your 20s. It will go all the way up to $4,000 if you're in your 60s. Some people feel that creates a new entitlement program, and they therefore think it's too much big government. I think that is always going to stay in there, though, because I think people are used to getting a subsidy under Obamacare, so they think that's, and enough Republicans, again, ran on some sort of tax subsidy, that will not come out, and there will be something like that in there in the end. The rationalization for it, for those conservatives in the room who think it's wrong, is if you have insurance under your employer, that is tax exempt. In other words, if you got a $10,000 raise from your employer, you'd have to pay income tax on it. If you're getting a $10,000 health insurance policy from your employer, you're not paying tax on that. So the idea being that if you don't have insurance through your employers, maybe the government can help you out a little bit as well. Those are their two major concerns. The more moderate element, or the element that doesn't mind having the government a little bit more involved in health care, I think their major concern was that under Obamacare, there were some mandates for certain coverages insurance companies had to provide. Maybe the most controversial is maybe a generous coverage on mental health and coverage on drug and opiate, drug abuse, alcohol abuse. And I think some of the more moderate types wanted to include that under the new plan as well. I think that would raise the overall cost of insurance, and we want to keep the overall cost of insurance down. But that was one of their objections, so the thing fell apart. As of last week when I left, we had felt the so-called Freedom Caucus, or the conservative types, had signed off on the new plan that was out there, but the more moderate types, which is also known as the Tuesday group, had not signed off. And that's why we did not vote on it on Friday, which I was expecting to do. It would not surprise me if I vote on that plan, however, sometime in the next 2 weeks. I almost expect to vote for it next week. I'm flying out tomorrow morning. But that's kind of what's going on there on that. The next thing we're going to be looking at is our budget. And I am on the budget committee. That's not quite as important as it sounds. We are going to begin to start down the path of putting together the budget. Right now, the federal government is very broke. I assume some of you are here asking to make sure that we don't cut some programs or maybe to add some new programs. I want to remind you that in the near future, we're going to hit $20 trillion in debt. That's not what the accountants say the debt is. That's real debt that's out there. That's about $60,000 for every man, woman, and child in the country, which is just shocking. I mean, think about that. You have a family of four. In addition to your, you know, credit card that you owe, or whatever you owe on a car payment or a mortgage, you owe $240,000 as your share of the federal debt. So I'm very reluctant to ever spend any more, because that is a huge amount of debt. In the budget, that's one of the things that we're going to be looking at. So you understand how difficult it is to put together the federal budget. About 70% of the federal budget is what we call mandatory spending. Mandatory spending is not exactly, but largely things that you are entitled to under current law by filling out a government form. It may be things that you've worked your whole life for, like Medicare or Social Security. It also includes things would be income-based payments, things that some people refer to as welfare payments, and it also includes interest on the federal debt. The interest on the federal debt continues to grow, and as you watch interest rates grow, who does that affect more than anybody else? The federal government. But in any event, on our budget, that kind of leaves us with the remaining 30%. Of that 30%, traditionally, about one half is defense, one half is non-defense. Donald Trump has committed to raising defense spending. I think if you talk to anybody, your children, your grandchildren in the military, they will tell you that right now things are kind of bare bones in the defense. There are places where we are wasting money, but I think if we're going to maintain a top flight military, that's why Donald Trump is raising the defense budget by 3%, and quite frankly, most people thought he was going to raise it by more than that. The big fight I'm going to be dealing with is not people who think we should be spending less than 3% more, it's people who feel we ought to be spending more than that. But as the result, it kind of leaves, if you're going to cut something, the remaining 15% of the budget. And that's the situation we find ourselves in. So those are kind of, I think, the two big items. I see a gentleman here up front talking about taxes. We are going to try to redo the Internal Revenue Code. Donald Trump came up with a, released last week, just a vague overview of the type of cuts that he wants. But we haven't seen the details yet. We do have to do something with our top corporate rate. Right now, the top corporate rate in the United States is 35%. It's the highest in the industrialized world. There are two problems with that. When big multinational corporations decide where they're going to expand or where they're going to cut back, it puts the United States at a disadvantage. It also means that right now, if a big corporation makes money overseas, maybe they're making money in China, they're making money in Ireland, they're making money in Germany, if they bring that money back to the United States, they'll be taxed significantly on it. If they reinvest that money in the other countries, they will not be taxed on it. So we want to do something to bring that money back in the United States for more jobs. The other committees I'm on are education and the workforce. Hopefully we'll get some questions about that later tonight. I mean, my goal on education, first of all, is to get the federal government not have so many rules related to education. We made some progress on that last time. I'd like to make more progress now. In particular, we're taking up a bill dealing with free and reduced lunch. If you talk to your children or grandchildren, you'll find out that a lot of times they don't like the food right now, and a lot of times the reason they don't like the food is because they're required by the federal government as to what they can serve. On that committee, we're also dealing with student loans. I would like to get something through that you can refinance your student loans and have a lower interest rate. I'd also like to make sure that in the future, the colleges and universities have to sign off before you get a student loan. We hear from the colleges and universities, and just common sense, that sometimes 18 and 19 year olds are taking out bigger student loans than they have to for, I guess what I'll say, lifestyle decisions. You know, you can spend more money if you take it out now, but that's not so enjoyable when you're 25 or 30 or 40 years old. The final committee I'm on is a committee called Government Oversight. We deal with whatever scandals there the chairman decides to pick up. And it's not surprising, the busiest committee that I'm on in Washington. But that's a little bit about the committees I'm dealing with. I'm glad to be here in Neenah. It's a big district. I do try to get up here and meet as many people as I can on weekends. The job is 3 weeks in Washington, 1 week back, but I do come home every weekend and try to meet with people. And it's like I said, it's a sizable district. We've got somebody here who's from a little bit of Milwaukee County I represent. It goes north along Lake Michigan, north of Two Rivers, and across the middle of the state, all the way to Wisconsin Dells. The biggest cities in the district are Oshkosh, Sheboygan, Fond du Lac, Manitowoc, and Neenah's the fifth biggest city. The one unique thing about the district is there are 435 congressmen. There are more manufacturing jobs in this district than anywhere else in the country, which is kind of surprising. You'd figure that most manufacturing would be in like Chicago or Detroit or Houston or somewhere. Nope, it's right here in the 6th Congressional District. So you see all these factories, you think that's the way it is all around the country, but more here than anywhere. Okay, there's my kind of little overview of what I think is going on. Now what we'll do is, do we have questions? People have been filling out cards. Okay, Bernadette. Oh, I figured. Okay. You want me to read it? Okay, Roger Kranitz. Will you sign on the bipartisan House, I can't read the word, Solutions Caucus?
Climate Solutions.
He's right there.
Okay, all right. Oh, okay. Climate Solutions Caucus, like Mallier just did, in your letter to us. How about that? Pretty good catch. Indicated you would support a market-based solution to climate issues, and this caucus does just that. I haven't been approached about it yet, but if it's a... I will look at it. You know, a lot of these caucuses, there are many, many sort of caucuses, and, you know, somebody's got to show it to me. But this is the reason we have my staff here, is Bernadette will be heading back to Washington tomorrow, and she will remind me to look at it right away tomorrow morning. The question is, there's a climate caucus that, here, let me explain.
Let him ask.
Yeah, why don't you ask? Sure.
Glenn, you have a...
There's an extra mic in there, so you have a...
Oh, I see, I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you for letting me state my question. Anyway, the question was, Mike Gallagher just signed on to the House Bipartisan Committee on Climate Solutions Committee. And in your letter to us, April of last year, you said that you'd be supportive of climate things if they were market-based and market-driven. And so, that caucus is exactly that from the Citizens Climate Lobby.
Okay, I will look at it right away tomorrow. So you understand a caucus is, it's just a group of legislators who agree sometimes to meet collectively and maybe work on legislation. And sometimes those caucuses, quite frankly, never meet, and sometimes they meet a few times a year. But I will make sure I look at it right away when I get back tomorrow.
Okay, Lou, I'm sorry, I'm not going to pronounce this correctly. Vasek?
Lou Blasek?
Blasek?
What is your position on climate change, and are you aware of the Bipartisan Climate Solutions Caucus? Gallagher again just joined the other day. He came on with a Democrat out of California.
Okay.
So I think there's pairs. You can only join if you're a Republican. You can only get on if a Democrat joins.
Oh, I heard about that. So I have to find a matching Democrat if I want to get on. Okay, I don't think it's a bad idea to have something that's 50-50, one Republican for every Democrat. I think Mark's probably already on, I think. I'll talk to Ron kind of. In general, I'm old enough to remember in the 1970s where they talked about global cooling.
Wow. A story on page 64 of Newsweek magazine.
Well, I did. Do you remember Newsweek magazine? Like, remembering that a lot of people wanted to do drastic things in the 70s, and drastic things weren't done, but I remember reading scare stories about how, you know, we wouldn't be able to grow wheat anymore in Canada and that sort of thing. But I will.
Owen just said that 4 years are record heat. What do you say about that?
Well, we'll be looking at it and
Okay. Evie Redden. As you know, federal funds currently do not pay for abortions. Planned Parenthood provides life-saving health care to millions of women. I have a 35-year-old daughter who uses the IRF services because she does not have employer health benefits. Help me to understand why you want to defund Planned Parenthood, and please do not use abortion as an excuse.
Planned Parenthood is the biggest abortion provider in the country. It is. They operate the big clinic in Madison.
Be honest.
I am being honest. They operate a big clinic in Madison. They operate a big clinic on the south side of Milwaukee. And I don't know that it's reopened, but they had one up in Appleton in the not too distant past.
What percent of their budget do they use for that? It's tiny.
They also are an outspoken advocate for what I'll call some controversial programs.
And like what?
Yeah,
cancer screening?
There's no other alternative. You look into every city, and you can get birth control in, I would guess, in Neenah.
Yes. You would guess?
6 or 10 different places. In pharmacists. In many grocery stores. Not to mention
Oh, I've never gotten a prescription from a grocery store.
My guess is in a city the size of Neenah, Menash, and Appleton, there have to be 6 or 8 clinics where you get birth control.
What about a rural community?
There are plenty other, and I did look into some of them and says, I don't like to respond to questions out of the blue, but I will say this. If you look at where all Planned Parenthood clinics are in the state of Wisconsin, they are usually in more urban areas. I looked one time, I got a list of all the clinics, Planned Parenthood clinics in the state of Wisconsin. I don't think there were any that I am aware of just perusing it in which you would say the village was so small that they didn't have any other health care providers. I mean, they'll throw that out, but if you look, it is usually in larger areas. And of course, there are many people who...
Answer the question. Answer the question.
Joel Schlachtenhoffen?
Oh, wow.
Joel?
This is also an EPA question. I think it says something like, our environment is in a terrible state, and not just in Wisconsin, but worldwide. And the question is, will you work to fully fund the EPA?
Well, first of all, I was looking earlier today at a variety of metrics for air pollution, but you could say the same thing about air and water pollution. You could say the same thing about the Fox River, for that matter. Whether you look at lead, whether you look at ozone, whether you look at water pollution, right now our environment is much cleaner than it was.
Because of regulations, because of the EPA.
Right. As I mentioned, right now we are $60,000 in debt per person in this country. Our tax burden as a percent of GDP is higher than it historically been in over the last 50 years. So we also have right now, and I think it's going to grow, a generous zero bracket amount where I think, which is fine, in which people don't make a lot of money are not paying taxes right now.
How come GE doesn't pay any taxes? They make a lot of money.
But I will also point out in the last budget that we voted for, the federal government was borrowing about 14%. I mean, if in your own lives you looked at your income, or you looked at what you spent last year, and not only were you going through all the money that you were taking in, but were borrowing an additional 14%, you would say that is a crisis. So I am...
So you'll cut taxes, huh?
So what's this got to do with the EPA? So,
I think
they are... They're
going to
cut the income.
Right now, the goal of the tax proposal was put up by the Ways and Means Committee. They had a big problem with that proposal, but was to be what they'd call revenue neutral. In other words, some taxes would go up and some taxes would go down. But in any event, as I mentioned, I think we have to look very closely at every part of the budget, given that I don't want to cut Medicare, I don't want to cut Social Security, I will not cut Social Security. At every other agency. So, there you are. So we are going to have the EPA, and I would be surprised if just about every other agency, I don't think we're going to cut veterans' benefits, but I think just about every other agency out there is going to take some sort of cut, and I'd be very surprised if the EPA didn't take some sort of cut next year compared to last year.
All right, Joanne Kaus? Joanne?
They're all behind me.
I have several questions here. What are your thoughts on eliminating pre-existing conditions for healthcare? I think you said you will not vote for eliminating pre-existing conditions. Is that what I heard you say tonight?
The bill that we will vote on, the bill that I actually voted on out of committee, does not allow insurance companies to discriminate on the basis of pre-existing conditions. And I would be very shocked, just stunned, if the eventual compromise changes current law.
They'll just move it to a high-risk pool.
I'll just give you one question. Maybe we'll have time for later, and you know, I'm not going to spin out of here, but I really got to kind of stick with one question a person. Or,
so are you comfortable dropping health care for 21 million people?
I don't think we're going to be dropping health care for 21 million people. Like I said, I really should only be taking one question per person, because given the volume of people, I know I'm not even going to get to everybody. So we'll try to limit it to one question per person.
All right, Jerry Scribner?
Go ahead.
Do you want the mic?
You mentioned in your remarks that we're headed toward a $20 trillion deficit, and how much we're piling up in debt. And the biggest thing on the plate in Washington right now is making that even bigger by giving tax cuts to millionaires and billionaires. You promise not to vote for a tax cut if it increases the deficit.
The goal of the tax cut is to energize the economy. Our corporate rate is discouraging companies from coming here.
The effective tax rate is more like 20.
Discouraging people from coming back. The marginal rate is 35%.
What's the effective rate?
You follow me. Been critical of the Ways and Means Committee tax cut that was kind of circulated because I don't think it was strong enough for the middle class. And I'm very conscious of that. I think right now the tax code currently has provisions in it which disproportionately help what you refer to as the rich. I also think the tax code is very generous to people who might not be working as hard as they could. And I think it's true in a lot of ways. Things can be set up to benefit the ultra rich, and we can be generous with people who aren't working that hard, but the middle class guy does not get as good enough a deal as he should. Now, the Trump proposal out there does not have a lot of the details filled in, so I can't really comment in particular on everything, but I can assure you, I used to do taxes. My goal, when eventually we are called to vote upon a change in the tax law, is to make sure that the average guy is protected. And I do sometimes feel, looking at Washington, that there are people there ready to look out for what I'll call the really rich, and politicians like to look out for people who they would describe as poor. And the middle class guy does not get a fair deal, and that is where I'm going to weigh in among other ways when the details of this tax cut come out, because I do want to look out for the, you know, whatever, however you describe the average guy, and we all have different definitions about what that is, but I do think they have not done as well as they should in America in the last 20 years, and I'll look out for them.
What about the banks?
Right now, the proposal, or the initial proposal out of the Ways and Means Committee, I know there are Trump's proposals this way as well, the original proposal was supposed to be what we call revenue neutral. Some taxes go up, some taxes go down. We're yet to see what the details are in the Donald Trump proposal. Obviously, he plans on getting rid of some of the tax deductions, and the idea being we're going to simplify our taxes, get rid of some deductions and credits, but overall the rates will drop. Because I don't have all the details haven't been released yet, I can't comment on that entirely, but the goal, I think, will be to be revenue neutral and not to increase the deficit.
I'm sorry, does Trump write the tax law, or does Congress?
Congress does, but a lot of people, I shouldn't respond to people calling up, but ultimately, Donald Trump will sign whatever change there is in the tax law, and ultimately will have to pass both houses of Congress.
I believe it's Marcel Garcia.
Right here. I don't need a microphone. I think I can speak loud and clear. I'm a migrant. This country's being built in migrants. We're in a global economy, but we need to build bridges, not walls. wrong to building a wall? First of all, it's expensive. We don't have the money, as you said, for that.
Yep.
It's useless.
What is your question?
Let me talk, okay?
What's the question?
A lot of people don't cross the border, come here. Most of them come here by plane, or stay visas in here. What if you build a wall? A lot of people here from Asia, Europe. So why are you still supporting to a wall to be built in, and how you expect that to pay? Don't say the Mexican pay for that, because they're not.
Okay. There seems to be a fundamental disagreement on immigration in this country. This is a country of immigrants, and there's no question we need more immigrants. We need it for our economy. We need it because some people would be better off coming here, just as a humanitarian thing. And we need it because, the population is not growing as quickly in this country as it historically did. The question is, when we get immigrants to this country, are we going to get immigrants that are vetted and that, you know, we can be reasonably certain people are going to come here with jobs, aren't going to become a public charge, that sort of thing, or are we going to take people who come here illegally? It is apparent that for the last three or four administrations, people or the government didn't care a great deal if people came in here illegally. There are a variety of reasons why that is a problem. But above all, we want to make sure that people who come here are going to be an asset to America. Now, right now, there is a cost to America in getting people here who don't necessarily meet that standard. Okay. We have people coming here, particularly if you talk to people in the southern part of the United States, who are coming here and using our health care system. One of the problems we have in this country is the cost of health care is going through the roof, and one of the reasons for that is we are getting people here who are coming here, perhaps illegally, using our generous medical system. Secondly, we have people coming here, if you talk to people who are dealing with government benefits, who are coming here and taking advantage of those government benefits. We have enough people here who are already getting government benefits.
Like Walmart.
More. So we want to make sure that people want people taking advantage of that. We also have people who are coming from other countries who wind up in our criminal justice system. That's another problem we have. We want to do what we can to make sure we are picking the people coming in this country. And if you're going to pick people who come in this country, you have to make sure people don't come here illegally. I think common sense would tell you, if you have two groups of people, one group of people waiting 9 or 10 years to get off the waiting list and come here legally, and another group of people are coming here illegally, who do you think is going to improve America more as we look at the next 5 or 10 or 50 years? Obviously, it's people.
It's not obvious.
That you'd rather have people coming here legally.
Yes.
And that is one of the reasons why one of the reasons we're going to build the wall is
The money you spend building a wall, that's the money you can spend providing services.
Richard Turner, right there. Thank you.
I got 7 questions on it.
What is your definition of welfare reform?
What is your definition? Because you're a big supporter of welfare reform.
Absolutely.
And we had huge welfare reform under Clinton. Huge. There's very few people on welfare in the state of Wisconsin.
Okay. The number of people on food share, which is one form of welfare. Was about 17 million people in the year 2000. It is now about 43 million. I think when you have the number of people on food stamps go up from 17 million to 43 million in 17 years, that's a crisis.
Most of those people on food share, food stamp, whatever you want to call it, same thing, most of those people are working. Many of them.
And I will tell you this. Right now, we have a huge, what I'll call, welfare system.
It includes, it includes subsidies.
I'm going to ask you to expand that when you talk about what they are.
Well, there is, you got the food share, you got subsidies for low-income housing, you got subsidies for medical care, you have a TANF grant that can come into play, you have grants that are income-based
temporary assistance for needy families, isn't that food stamps?
Grants, well, TANF is a direct check. You have grants for job training and that sort of thing. The problem is this, when you have earned income tax credit. The problem is this, when you add these things up, it is easy to come up with hypotheticals in which people are getting over $30,000.
Hypotheticals.
The problem is this, ultimately these things have to be taken away. Now, you hit on something which is true, because if you earn income tax credit, the best situation, you want to take advantage of these systems, these benefits the most, you should work a little bit. Because the earned income tax credit gives you more money if you work a little bit. But all of these benefits begin to get taken away from you when you begin to make more than $13,000 a year. They also begin to get taken away from you if you get married to somebody with a decent salary, because you're no longer perceived to be in poverty. So the current welfare system discourages work and discourages marriage. Okay, that is a huge problem. So what is the answer? What is my goal in welfare reform? I think we should stop having a situation in which you hear again and again from employers. Employees say, I can't work harder or I'll lose my benefits, or I can't get a raise to lose my benefits. We don't want to discourage people from working, and I want to stop hearing the anecdotal evidence that's out there that people don't want to get married, because if they get married, they lose a lot of their benefits. So the goal of the welfare system is to stop those two things. Now, some people say, why can't you phase them out? Obviously, we have a system, you know, a group of benefits that might be worth $25,000, $30,000. If you begin to phase them out, you can wind up in a situation
where 10-year-old kids are going to have to get married.
$40,000 or $45,000.
Regarding the food share, what do you plan on reducing the current amount of food share to? And then the other four things that you mentioned that you considered welfare, including housing subsidy, which I'm sure an awful lot of real estate people would complain about if you did. Could you tell us what your plan on reducing those four or five things?
You hit on something, and then it is true, it is going to be difficult on some of these welfare things to deal with them, in that a lot of wealthy people are making money off of welfare.
Huge.
And that is a problem. Nevertheless, I think we should agree that it is good if people work harder, and we shouldn't discourage people from working or working from full time. I think we should also not discourage people from getting married. And those are two things we should look at. I think some of the things we can do is we can take and put time limits on that. I think we have to put some drug testing in there.
Sue Neepkins.
We gave you plenty of answers.
Sue Neepkins. So, right there. Go ahead, ma'am. Go ahead.
Well, okay.
I have a question about the Hearing Protection Act of the 2017 that will eliminate taxes on gun silencers and amends the federal criminal code to preempt state or local laws that tax or regulate firearm silencers. How can you justify co-sponsoring this bill?
I think there's certain things the federal government ought not be involved in.
Life? Like marriage?
Marriage?
Eating?
I do think the Second Amendment protects the right to bear arms. And insofar as we protect the right to bear arms, I think that is a good thing and consistent with what our forefathers wanted.
David Vandercook?
I don't need Mike.
My grandparents got kicked out of the country twice because they were Romanians, but they had a Hungarian passport. Somehow they got in. So I don't know if that made my mom illegal or not or what, but she was born here and I'm stuck here and whatever. Well, my question or my comment is, American Farm Bureau Federation, are you aware of that organization?
I know the American Farmers.
Would you say that they're on the conservative side?
Well, I think they're in favor of farmers, so I guess if being in favor of farmers is conservative, we'll say they're conservative.
Well, their estimate on their website said that 50 to 70% of their workers in certain fields are undocumented. They expect, as a result of what's going on now, that food prices will go up at least 7% or $60 billion that we're going to have to come up with just because of higher food prices, because they're not going to have the workers.
Well, I don't know what they mean by not having the workers. I believe that...
They're not going to be harvesting the grapes, the tomatoes, the beans, or whatever.
Milk in the
onions.
House.
They're not going to be working.
They're
and
right
as
now.
A result, to hire somebody, they're going to have to pay somebody else more money or whatever, and my prices are going to go up at the grocery store 7%.
Well, there is
everybody else in here too.
There is no question. I think that probably collectively, not necessarily in agriculture, but collectively, the policy of letting a lot of people in this country illegally does drive down wages. And I think it is, it's unfortunate.
Driving down wages?
Right. I do think that you mentioned special interest, and it is unquestionably true. I think that one of the reasons we don't enforce our immigration laws is to make sure that the cuts proposed by Donald Trump are not in there. Now, you've got to realize there'll probably be some cut just because of the dire situations we're in. But I'm aware what a good program that is, and I'll make sure you get the entire company's proposal. Okay, I am not going to sprint out of here, so I'll be hanging around for a while talking to you folks. If anybody has any individual problems with the federal government, we have Bernadette here, we have Alex here, we have Al going around here somewhere.
She does take you and ask more questions then.
I'll be talking to people on an individual basis. And again, thank you for being here. It was a great time.